Howdy, I'm Kris and I'm American, and today I'm going to learn how to speak with a British accent.
Hello, my name's Gideon, I'm British, and today I'm going to learn how to speak with an American accent.
It's scary, it's accent swap.
Hello and welcome to Let Them Talk TV. Can a Brit learn to speak American English? Can an American learn to speak British English? To help us find out, I've invited today the legendary Kris Amerikos onto this channel. Hello, Kris. How are you today?
How are you doing? I'm good. How are you?
Fine. I like the shirt, by the way. You've come well prepared. Yeah.
I just woke up and put it on. You know, it's what I wear every day.
Sure. Well, I'm wearing British underwear. But I'm not going to show that to the viewers. So,
that's for a different channel.
Yeah, exactly. That's what my other, the other channel. Check it out. Yes, my OnlyFans channel. Are you ready for the challenge?
I am.
Yeah. So I'm going to teach you some British English, and you're going to teach me some American English. We've got a little dialogue at the end of this video. Viewers are going to vote on who does it best. Does the American do a better British accent than the Brit does an American accent? Yeah, so fun and games are over, Kris.
Okay, I'm
now,
serious.
Now it's
serious.
It's war. Battle is on. I think your job is tough because I'm very bad at accents, especially American accents. I can do one or two British ones, but whenever I try, I fail miserably. So you've got your work cut out today.
I don't believe that at all.
You're
but we'll find out soon.
Yeah. Who are you, by the way? tell us who you are.
Oh, me?
Who is this Kris Amerikos we've heard so much about?
Yeah, so I'm Kris from chrisamerikos.com, where we help you level up and take your English to the next level, meet people from around the world, and practice speaking English. And I wanted to make this video together with you today because I think that a lot of people around the world choose British English or American English. And it's good to remember that there are speakers who pronounce words differently and spell words differently. And if someone does it differently, it doesn't always mean that it's wrong.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Well said. And I should say, although we speak with different accents, we understand each other 100%. That's one of the things about English. People, I get in the comments, oh, I don't understand American English or American English. But I think that they're mutually
intelligible.
Understandable, intelligible, aren't they?
Yeah. And where do you draw the line, though? Because there are some, you know, subcultures with slang where I might not understand what someone from Ireland, Northern Ireland, from even, you know, Scotland, what they're saying, and because the slang is so much different.
That's true. That's a very good point. Because today we're doing what we call standard British. There's no standard. I know we're going to get people in the comments. There's no standard British English. It's all this and that.
Well, RP.
Just RP, SSB, I call SSBE, whatever you call it. It's just the as close as you get to a standard British English, is your American? I've got a slight London accent, so not mine, not 100% standard, but pretty close. And your accent is what?
I've lived all over the place, but most of my family's from Ohio.
Okay.
And so I'd say I take most of how I speak from that. So I don't know. I try to speak with a non-regional accent when I'm teaching.
Okay. Yeah, same here. Is it called, General American English? Standard American? What do you call it?
Yeah, Standard American English. Or like in the news and, you know, when people are speaking to large audiences in the country, mm-hmm. then they're going to try to speak without a regional accent. So, news readers, for example, would have to speak like that.
Okay. All right. Well, as I've got a slight London accent, but it's not very strong. When I'm teaching, I certainly reduce that considerably. So we're going to go through, I think, what, 6 points here, where I'm going to teach you some British way, some typically ways of speaking, and you can show us the differences. Okay, I'm going to get my list up here, and the first one is roticity. Roticity, which is...
Roticity.
Roticity, yes. And that is that in most British accents, including the standard Southern British English, we don't roll the R's, okay? And a few regional dialects do, but in standard English, standard British English, you don't roll the R, so you say car and father and... far, and I guess in American that's different, isn't it?
Yeah, we usually pronounce the R at when it has the last position in the word,
okay.
Especially immediately after a vowel. So yeah, father instead of father.
Okay, well I'm going to get you to say this phrase in a British way. Remember, car, not car. Car. So. The car started to turn on the curvy road. Can you say that?
The car started to turn onto the curvy road.
That's quite good. That's quite good. Okay, now I have to... Now, have you got any tips for me? I have to say it. I guess... say it in American ways? Because I
sure,
have to
sure. It. The car started to turn onto the curvy road.
Oh, my God. The car started to turn onto the curvy road. Is that okay?
I think you got it, yeah.
I got one more sentence here.
For rotisserie?
For rotisserie.
Roticity.
The guitar player was at the bar far away. Can you say it?
The guitar player was far... Sorry. The guitar player was... Player. Can you say it again?
Player.
Player. The guitar player was at the bar far away.
Very good. I think bar, you continue to put the R on. Bar.
Bar.
But you're just going to imagine there's no R there. It just makes the vowel longer. Try again.
The guitar player was at the bar far away.
Very good. Yeah, good. Thumbs up, Chris. Okay. Now, can you help me with the American version?
The guitar player was at the bar far away.
Oh my God, I'm not going to say it. The guitar player was at the bar far away. Is it okay?
Yeah. Yeah, I think you got it.
You're not just
the
being nice.
Guitar player. Yeah, I think it's okay. Easy. That was an easy one for you.
It's easy if you know it. I don't know. I find that very tricky. Okay. All right. That's the R. So listen out there. British, yeah. English. No R's, except when you're linking to, if it's the end of the world and the next word starts with a vowel, then you can put the R far away, something like that. So you can link
right.
It, but otherwise, you don't. Next one, and this one's interesting, it's the R sound, which, interesting, in the south of England we say, but in the north, I think it's maybe a bit closer to American English. So I'll give you an example. The bath. You say bath. I'm going to have a bath. Mm-hmm. Not take a bath. Not take a bath. Have a bath. And you say fast.
Mm-hmm.
Fast. And again, father. Father. And I'd rather. So I've got a sentence for you. So this is the R sound. I'd rather have a bath than walk fast on the last path with my father.
I'd rather have a bath. Then walk fast on the last path with my father.
Yeah. It's rather. I think you said rather or something. Rather.
I'd rather have a bath than walk fast on the last path with my father.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Okay. Can you help me with this one then? I think I'm
This one's going to be a little harder for you, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
So I'd rather have a bath than walk fast on the last path with my father.
Ooh. I noticed the father sound, the vowel changes with father, doesn't it?
Okay. Father.
I'd rather have a bath than walk fast on the last path with my father.
Yeah.
There's a bit
I'd
of
rather
hesitation.
Have a bath.
You hesitated. No. Did you hesitate for a reason?
No. It's good.
Just a normal, you know. everyday.
Just normal British guy doing an American accent, yeah.
Okay, I was concerned by that hesitation.
No. I think it was intelligible.
Intelligible, but not perfect then.
Say it again.
Okay, I'm going to try once more. Can you say it once more?
I'd rather have a bath than walk fast on the last path with my father.
I'd rather have a bath than walk fast on the last path with my father.
Yeah. There's something, I'm trying to figure it out. There's something about the th sound that we're doing differently.
Okay. In rather and father?
No, with path, I think. Path. And bath.
Bath, path.
Uh-huh. Bath, path.
Bath, path. Bath, path. Not quite right.
No. I think it's fine.
Okay. Well, in that case, we'll go on to the next one. This one I think is a little bit easier. It's the T's. The T's and D's.
Oh, this one, yeah.
I think it's a bit easier because in British English, when you have a T between vowels, you say the T because it's a T. Logical. So for us, it's logical. So you say Italy and better and water and butter. It's true that some English speakers, including myself, sometimes may use a glottal stop instead of a T. As I said, water, better. But we're not doing that today. Just do the T's. Water, better, city, and I think in American English sometimes they're D's, aren't they?
It sounds like a D, yeah. It sounds more like a D. We still think it's a T, but
okay. But, well, I've got a sentence. So because we haven't really rehearsed this, you know, this is you think we've just been practicing.
No, we haven't rehearsed at all.
No. We had a quick chat for 5 minutes beforehand, and we're going straight into it. I'll say it in British English. The water in Italy is a little better than in the city of Moscow. I put in Moscow there for the, because that's different as well, I think. Go ahead.
The water in Italy is a little better than in the city of Moscow.
Very good. No, it's fine. Sounds like you're trying very hard. That's the only thing. There are beads of sweat coming down. But the phonetics is
it's like a spy,
a joy to behold.
It's like a spy movie. This is like the secret phrase. He comes to the door and he's, the water in Italy is a little better than in the city of Moscow.
Exactly.
And they open the door. Oh, okay, come in.
Exactly. I think you'd be a good spy. Although probably you'd have to change your shirt if you did.
Yeah.
But, it gives the game away which side you're on. But
I'm from Canada.
Yeah.
I'm from Canada.
Okay. So now help me with the American version.
Okay.
Of this one.
The water in Italy is a little better than in the city of Moscow.
Ooh, that Moscow gets me all the time. The water in Italy is a little better than in the city of Moscow.
Yeah.
It's good?
Yeah, you see, I think that, you know, there are some choices that you could make in speaking American English that would put you in different categories of speakers. So, like, the same way that, like, when I'm speaking British English with you, you could probably identify like, okay, you didn't choose this sound or you said this sound in this word and that sounds like this accent, right? So what I can say about your American English is that it sounds close to like New England English, where they very often, you know, don't pronounce the R at the end of the word. Mm-hmm. There are some choices like the pronunciation of the word water.
Mm-hmm.
So it's more rounded. Okay. The A is more rounded. It's closer to British English, basically.
Okay. Well, New England, I'm happy with that. What is that, like Massachusetts? And I'm happy if I can
Boston.
Get away with it. Boston.
Okay. In fact, if we go back to the car example that you had, the car started to turn onto the curvy road. I can give you an example that we use in American
English. Go ahead.
So, it's like a phrase that people can say as a joke about people from Boston. So in Boston, they have Harvard University.
Mm-hmm.
you can, the phrase is, I parked my car I parked my car in Harvard Yard. This is the phrase. I parked my car in Harvard Yard. Now, I'm saying it with my my typical American accent, not like a person from Boston.
Okay.
But, so, I parked my car in Harvard Yard. Can you say that?
I parked my car in Harvard Yard.
Yeah.
I think it's, I sound a bit Indian or something. I sound quite right.
But a Bostonian, a person from Boston, would say, I parked my car in Harvard Yard.
Okay. So, all right. Well, if I'm Boston, I can live with that. I can live with that. It's nice.
Can you say it like that? I parked my car in Harvard Yard.
That sounds a bit easier to me. I parked my car in Harvard Yard.
Uh-huh.
It sounds easier to say that because, you know, it's a bit closer to British English than the roticity, which I get stuck on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm. Cool.
Okay. So that is the T sound. Got a couple more. And so there you are. T's are T's in British English. Easy to remember, huh? T's are not necessarily T's in American English, although they say that they are. So difference of opinion. Right, the next one is the O sound. I'm not sure you have the sound in American English. You have to tell me. It's the O. Like in got.
Hot.
Lot. At the top.
Lot.
There was a cot. Bot, at the bottom. You say that sound, do you? You don't hear much in American English.
Not a lot.
Yeah, well, here's the phrase. Yeah, exactly. So the phrase I've got for you, I got hot a lot at the top.
I got hot a lot at the top.
Perfect. Absolutely perfect. Chris, you're doing it very well. Congratulations.
Again, I think the New England accent has this, it sounds more like this, because a standard American accent person is going to say, I got hot a lot at the top. Can you say
it? I'm going to try that now. Yes. Yeah. I got hot a lot at the top.
Yeah, you sound... That was very American. Oh,
be kind. Don't forget this is a battle.
You know? Oh, yeah.
The gloves are off now. The next one is... So some words are pronounced differently in British English and American English. And I've got a list here, and you can tell me if I'm wrong. So I've got... schedule, yeah. Although I keep hearing British people saying schedule these days. I think they've been listening to a lot of American stuff. I hear British people saying schedule, so it's not as clear.
Yeah, maybe that one's changing in our favor.
Yeah.
So who's winning this battle? Who's winning this battle now?
Of course, America's going to win because most of like the sort of media and the films and stuff, that's all in American English. So we get more exposure to that.
But most of the English as a foreign language education is British English based.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. I mean, if we on the global scale.
Okay. I say herb. I'm going to put some herbs on my pizza.
And we say herbs.
Herbs with the R. But I think the Americans are kind of correct because it comes from French, and in French you don't say the H. So it would have originally been herb, something like that. And then
another tennis situation. It was popular in France before it was popular anywhere else. But they would hit the ball to the other person and say something like tenez. And
take it.
Yeah. And so the English person sees this word and there's an S that's not pronounced at the end, is probably pronounces it instead of tennis. And over the period of like 50 years, I forget how long, it became less popular in France, more popular in England. And then it became popular around the world through English. And that's why it's still called tennis, even though it came from the French.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, that's interesting. And I thought it had a connection with tennis. I didn't know that. Yeah, they say tennis, don't they? They say, yeah, that's very interesting. Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks for that. Thanks for a little history lesson.
I know you like etymology of words.
I do. I do like etymology. Yeah. Well, we'll go into that in great detail another time, I hope. I've got a few other words. I noticed that in American English, it's often two pronunciations. And I've got root down. I say root. I've heard root, in American English, root and route. Which one is
both.
Correct?
Or
both are correct.
Yeah.
Okay. So is it regional, the difference?
Yeah, it's probably regional. Honestly, I'm not sure. I haven't thought about that before, about who uses which one. But it's probably more of like a Midwest thing, like the center part of the country, like Pennsylvania, Ohio, Indiana, that area. So to say route, I think most people say root.
Root. Okay. But what about niche?
Niche. So a lot of people say niche. And I think that the people who say niche just never connected the dots to the French word.
Okay. Do you have a car, Kris?
A car?
Yeah.
Or a car?
An automobile.
Yeah, an automobile. Yeah.
Yes, you do.
For sure. As a short word, can you say auto? Do you have an auto?
Do you have an auto?
No. Do you ever say that? No, not like, I think no. Germans say that. No,
we never say that. I've never heard that before.
Yeah, so all Americans have a car, is that what you're saying?
No, I was going to say you put your car in a garage, don't you?
Yeah, in the garage.
The garage. Did you manage to put your car in the garage today?
I managed to put my car in the garage.
Oh, okay. Right, there you are. It's different. And do you have some flowers? Where do you put your flowers?
Depends what I'm cooking. What? I'm joking. I just wanted to, that was a test for all the viewers, if they know the difference between countable and uncountable meaning of this noun, you know?
Okay.
No, flowers in a vase. I put my flowers in a vase, yeah.
We have a vase.
Uh-huh.
My vase is made of aluminium.
Oh, you have an aluminum vase?
Yeah.
An aluminum vase? I think we even spell that one differently.
That's true. I think aluminum was originally British as well, but you took it and we reverted to something else.
They're like, oh, those guys have it. We don't want it. Get that out of here. So here, this brings up one of the other points that we're going to address today, right? The T plus U in British English, you add in the Y before U, and this changes the pronunciation of the T so that you pronounce some of these combinations as Ch, where I pronounce them T. Right?
Absolutely. So, yeah, I was going to do that one, actually. Yeah. That was the final one on my list. We'll do it now.
Okay.
I'll go back to a few vocabulary differences in a minute. I had that one. So this platform we're using right now, we are on YouTube, aren't we?
YouTube? Yeah.
And today is Tuesday, isn't it?
It's Tuesday. No, today's Monday. Tomorrow's Tuesday.
Monday. But tomorrow's Tuesday. Most Tuesday, and there's a big opportunity for you somewhere, Kris.
Most days provide an opportunity.
Opportunity, and other ones. Sometimes the DJ difference, like I say duty, and you would say
duty, or duty, with the D with a T that sounds like a D.
Okay. So I've got this phrase here. I'm using some of the words we just used. So I'll read it in British English. The opportunity on YouTube on Tuesday is a duty.
The opportunity on YouTube on Tuesday is a duty.
Okay. I'm going to try and read that one myself in American.
Okay. Can you help me to tell you the American one?
Yeah. Yeah.
So, the opportunity on YouTube on Tuesday is a duty.
The opportunity on YouTube on Tuesday is a duty. On Tuesday. How do you say that? Tuesday.
Tuesday.
Tuesday. It's like two, the number two.
Yep, exactly.
On Tuesday. Because it's the second day of the week. So, Tuesday, yeah. No?
Yeah, exactly. It makes sense to us.
Now we've almost got this dialogue coming up, but I just got a bit more vocabulary here.
Okay.
A little insect is an ant.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. How do you say that?
Ant.
and your brother, your father's sister?
Father's sister, aunt.
Aunt, okay.
Or aunt.
Or aunt, okay.
Some people say aunt.
A gorilla is very hairy. How do you say that, hairy?
Hairy.
Okay, and the prince, the brother of Edward, is Harry. How do you say that?
Harry, same.
The same?
Yeah.
So you say it the same, but we say it different. Harry, Harry, but you, it's the same.
Okay, so you say Harry, Harry.
Yeah.
Okay. Harry.
Yeah.
Is the prince or whoever. Yeah. And Harry is with hair.
Yeah. And if you take a boat with lots of people on it across, I don't know, some stretch of water, it might be called a ferry.
Ferry, yeah.
Okay, and then the stories you tell to your children are fairy tales. Fairy.
Okay, you're going to have to say those two again for me.
Fairy, fairy.
Fairy, fairy.
And for you, is it the same?
Yeah, we say fairy for both.
Okay. Not very original, is it?
Fairy.
Kris, you're just saying the same.
Okay, one point for British English.
Okay. These aren't the same. They vary quite a lot. Vary.
Vary.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm very happy with this video.
Very. Very.
Is it the same or different?
Same for us.
Ah, really, Kris, come on. Get your finger out.
Very and very, you're saying, okay. Right?
And they threw the ball very. At me and I caught it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Caught.
Uh-huh.
And the little... I think it's different in British and American, but for you have a cot, which is like for a little
children. Bed.
Yeah, a little bed, a cot.
Uh-huh.
What's the difference? Quart, cot.
Right, those two sound the same in American English, but in British English,
it's different.
Quart, like someone threw something and you caught it, yeah. And also the police arrested you and you went to...
Court. No, that's the same. Yeah, that
was yeah, same. Those court. Two sound the okay. same. In British English, those two me. Sound the same.
You got me. You got me there. Okay. You got me that one. Okay. Okay. Point to you. Well done. I'll just finish this part of our conversation. I think the ILE words, Google tells me they're pronounced differently. Fertile, versatile, mobile.
Yeah.
You say it differently, do you?
Yeah, so here again, it varies between different speakers, not necessarily regionally. So, for example, some people will say versatile.
Okay.
Versatile. But some people will say versatile.
Oh, okay. Okay, so you have both.
Yeah, but right. I think the first version is favored, probably. Okay. But people will say both, yeah.
Okay.
Right. Fertile. Yeah. Fertile. Yeah, people will say both. Mobile. No, so yeah, I guess it depends what you're describing. If you're talking about a noun or as an adjective, right? Mobile would be how we usually say the adjective, mobile.
Okay.
But someone could say mobile and everyone would understand. But we never call this our mobile.
No.
This is our cell phone.
Your cell phone, okay, yeah.
Right, this is our cell phone. Yeah. Never our, you can say your mobile phone or mobile phone.
Okay.
But we don't use mobile as a noun.
Okay, yeah. Fair enough. Well, Kris, now's the moment you've been waiting for. The challenge is up. The game's afoot. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Think you can beat me? I have a little sketch. You're going to be the British guy. I'm going to be the American. And just for control, afterwards we'll do it in the so-called correct way where I'm the Brit and you're American. But are you ready for the challenge?
I'm scared, but let's go.
You should be. you should be. Well, you're scared with good reason. I'm going to whip your ass. No, okay.
Now, was that with an R or was that with two S's?
No, RSE. That's actually spelled differently, because that's interesting. It's one of the few words where the British English and American English spelt differently because the pronunciation is different, I think.
Yeah. Excuse me, but are you Peter Taylor, the famous investor?
Gosh damn it. Can a man walk along the sidewalk in peace without being interrupted? Jeez, it's Saturday. It's my day off. Get out of here.
Sorry, mate, but I just read your book, and it was bloody brilliant.
Well, nice of you to say.
My name's Graham Bottomley. Actually, I've got an investment opportunity that'll make you millions. Something not to be missed.
You want to make an elevator pitch, or do you call it a lift pitch where you come from?
No, we also say elevator pitch, but yes.
Okay, you've got 20 seconds, but hurry, I need to go to the bathroom.
Okay, well, it's a banana peeling machine. You place the fruit in the device, press the button, and Bob's your uncle. No fumbling around. Just a cleanly peeled fruit at your fingertips. It runs off Wi-Fi and can be accessed through our app anywhere in the world. And it's geolocatable, and it only costs $500. I've got one in the boot of my car. Shall I get it for you?
Absolutely not. That's the dumbest idea I've ever heard. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to get to my car. I'm meeting my daughter at the restaurant.
Can I join you? I'm feeling a bit peckish myself.
No, you cannot.
Or could I come to your office on Tuesday?
I'm going to Italy on Tuesday. Goodbye, Mr. Bottomley. Don't call us. We'll call you.
All right.
Well.
Cheers.
Cheers. Dear viewers, yeah, you have to vote on that. Put in the comments who did better. No pressure or anything, but you know, I'm the host of this channel, and you know, I have control over the comments. But no, but yeah, but who did better? I think actually Kris did pretty well. I don't like to admit it, Kris, but you were bloody brilliant.
How much I win?
You win the respect and kudos of all the viewers.
But kudos?
Yeah, but nothing
for you. And we say kudos.
Kudos. That sounds like a sweet. Some M&Ms and some kudos.
It does sound like that, yeah.
I think for just control purposes,
yeah.
So we just, so people can compare,
sure.
We should just read it in our normal accents. So I'll be the Brit. And you'd be the American, if that's okay.
Okay.
All right. Excuse me, but are you Peter Taylor, the famous investor?
Gosh darn it. Can't a man walk along the sidewalk in peace without being interrupted? Jeez, it's Saturday. It's my day off. Get out of here.
Oh, sorry, mate, but I read your book and it was bloody brilliant.
Well, nice of you to say.
My name's Graham Bottomley. Actually, I've got an investment opportunity that'll make you millions. Something not to be missed.
You want to make an elevator pitch? Or do you call it a lift pitch where you come from?
No, we also say elevator pitch, but yes.
Okay, you've got 20 seconds. Better hurry, I need to go to the bathroom.
Okay, well, it's a banana peeling machine. You place the fruit in the device, press the button, and Bob's your uncle. No fumbling around, just a cleanly peeled fruit at your fingertips. It runs off Wi-Fi, can be accessed through our app anywhere in the world, and it's geolocatable. And it only costs $500. I've got one in the boot of my car. Shall I get it for you?
Absolutely not. That's the dumbest idea I've ever heard. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to go get my car. I'm meeting my daughter at the restaurant.
Oh, can I join you? I'm feeling a bit peckish myself.
No, you cannot.
Or I could come to your office on Tuesday.
I'm going to Italy on Tuesday. Goodbye, Mr. Bottomley. Don't call us. We'll call you.
Very good. You did very well. Of course, you did well. You're doing your own. You're doing your own accent. You did. There you are. So you should see. Kris is pretty fantastic. So you should definitely check out his channel.
Oh, thanks.
Lots of great videos. I've been binge watching them recently. So that's why I thought we should have Kris on.
Thanks so much for having me on.
A pleasure. But I'm going to whip your ass. But nevertheless, it was a pleasure. And Kris, say goodbye to the viewers.
Vote for me. Vote for me. Vote for me. Put your votes down below.
Cut you off now. For me. Cut him off. Okay, and thank you. Stay tuned for more videos. Bye.
Bye.